We need to pay a lot more attention to what the faculties of education are teaching teachers, because they are transforming the elementary school and the junior high school and high school systems into nothing but propaganda machines for radical postmodernist doctrine. And if you don't believe me, you just go look it up on the web and see what they're attempting to impose. And so that's got to stop, right?
In recent videos, I've talked about Scottish education going into sort of BLM, race indoctrination, overdrive. So in this video, I'm going to look at another aspect of that, specifically at what we've got from the GTCS, the General Teaching Council for Scotland. Before I plunge into the race issue, I've just got here the envelope that their latest magazine arrived in. This is what it says on the outside of the envelope. Wellbeing, equality and diversity. Support for teachers in a new term, as well as the challenges of achieving equality and diversity in the profession. A fresh approach with a special focus on learning for sustainability. We consider our sector's ambitions for recovery and renewal. So both of the bits of text there, they're both on sort of politically correct, the left-leaning progressive issues. Then we've got an image here where at the top we've got a picture of heaven with a sort of socialist style housing block, high rise. Then we've got trees with birds singing, people on bicycles, wind turbines, the sun's rays streaking across the perfect blue sky. And underneath, we've got a hellish underworld. So what have we got there? We've got factories, I assume, producing pollution. We've got oil wells, it looks like. We've got pylons. I don't know how these people think electricity gets from wind turbines to places where it's needed. Anyway, we've also got cars. It's funny, last time I was at the GTC office, I seem to remember a car park being outside it. But anyway, we'll leave that aside. Cars. Worse still, a sports car in the middle. And then also in the dark, hellish underworld, we see an aeroplane. Anyway, moving on to race. Let's have a look at GTCS's website. They've got this section here. Opinion, fostering counter-narratives, encouraging the development of a critical understanding of racism in education. Critical understanding, in other words, critical race theory. So what's critical race theory? Quick summary. If you think to yourself, I treat everyone equally, I'm respectful to everyone, I don't hold any racist views, let alone behave in a racist manner ever, then you're very likely a racist and you're part of the problem. Even if you go out of your way to challenge racism, you write about it, talk about it, well, you're still probably a racist and part of the problem. Because according to critical race theory, what you have to do in order to not be a racist is you have to believe that we're in the midst of a racial power struggle in Britain. And we need to restructure every aspect of society in order to dismantle white privilege. And this is the philosophy that the Scottish government also is buying into. This is a quote from the government website. In one focus group, the working group was asked to consider using critical race theory as a framework to inform the work of the group. The working group did not discuss critical race theory in depth, but accepts that it's a useful framework to adopt in the journey towards better representation and participation of minority ethnic people in a range of areas. So the government's starting to accept this as well. Critical race theory should have been contained to consenting academics in the privacy of their own seminars, but inevitably it leaks out, partly because obviously they teach it to their students, and is now polluting the whole of society. So carrying on the GTCS website, we have a quote here from Melina. So what does anti-racist education look like? It involves a long journey of unlearning racism and some deep reflection on one's own racial identity, along with its privileges and disadvantages. Pretending not to see race and merely committing to being a good person is not enough. In fact, it's quite possible to unwittingly reinforce racism through microaggressions, implicit bias, and an ethnocentric curriculum that places white people at its centre. And this same article then provides a link to some helpful resources, and it provides a link to a website called the Anti-Racist Educator. Now, this is a Scottish group of, I assume, teachers, and they explain what they want in terms of so-called anti-racist education. So I had a look through their website and I found an article about exam results. Now obviously, people of this persuasion, they've got the equity mindset, the same as GTCS has. They also promote equity. Equity means equality of outcome. So what you do then is you look at any sort of results, break them down by sex, race, whatever, and then any differences you find must be a sign of injustice. So inevitably, these people look at the Scottish exam results from 2019. I think it's a National 5 they're looking at, and they break it down for different races, and then the hunt for injustice begins. Let's see what they find. Right, here are the overall statistics. 83% white Scottish, 9% white non-Scottish, 1.2% mixed. So in other words, the proportion of people of other ethnicities is very low, actually. But right, let's look at the results. Now, looking at these, we've got the percentage of pupils that achieved different grades. Now, the only percentage that's really meaningful to look at is an A. So if you look at a B, you know, if there's a higher or lower percentage getting a B, well, that doesn't mean if they perform better or worse. You can't tell from that. So just looking at grade A is the sensible thing. Right, first of all, look at male and female. 28.9% of males getting an A. 37.8% of females achieving an A on average. So that's a pretty substantial gap. Now, according to any sort of social justice ideology, they should be focusing on that and saying, right, what's going on here? Is it that the exam system or the education system is geared more towards females? You could maybe make a case for that. Is it that females just work harder than males? You can maybe make a case for that as well. Is it that the education system is better at motivating females than males? You can maybe make a case for that, because there are quite significant differences biologically between boys and girls. So that would be an interesting question. But obviously, they're not interested in that because the females come out better, so we can leave that. Right, on to ethnicity. What percentage get a grade A? White Scottish, 33%. White non-Scottish, slightly higher. You know, I mean, is that significant? Possibly not, but anyway, it's slightly higher. Mixed or multiple ethnic groups, quite a bit higher. I mean, almost 10% up on white Scottish. Indian, again, 12% up. Pakistani, about the same, 1% up. Chinese, 20% up on white Scottish. That's pretty significant. A small sample, pretty significant. Asian other, 35%, so slightly up. African, Black, Caribbean, sort of 5% down, 4% down on white Scottish. All other categories, 34%, not known, disclosed, 28%. Right, so looking at this, what conclusions can you draw about racism in Scottish education? Well, if racism is the answer to this, there must be a very strange positive racism that boosts Chinese students and pushes them to the top of the pile on average. That's very strange indeed, isn't it? Now, someone could try and make that case. They could try and say because people associate with sort of Chinese appearance with being clever, maybe that's it really. Okay, I don't believe that, but let's have a look at this. It said Indian and Pakistani. Are they distinguishable visually? I would suggest not. And yet, quite a significant difference here. I mean, is anyone seriously claiming there's some sort of racism that results in Indians doing better than white Scottish pupils and Pakistanis just doing about the same? Okay, so basically what you learn from this about racism? Basically nothing. It doesn't show anything significant at all. Now, of course, the people writing this blog on the anti-racist educator, they're not going to stop there, are they? They need to dig deeper to find evidence of injustice and discrimination. So what they do next is they go to the difference between predicted grade and actual grade, estimated grade and actual grade. So the idea is the bigger the difference, well, it might show that teachers underestimate the performance of minority ethnic pupils, and that's a form of discrimination. Now, all these figures are minus. That shows basically, the way I would put it is the teachers can't believe how easy the exam is. So even though the pupils do it year after year after year, the teachers still underestimate quite dramatically. And they, like I say, they can't believe how easy the exam is. That was my experience teaching with Scottish exams as well. You'd have boys who do mock exams one after another. They might do, say, 10, fail every single one. And yet you could be pretty confident when they go in on the day, they're going to pass it. It's as though they get a 10 mark head start in the actual thing. So what do we learn here? So the more negative the number, the more the underestimation of performance. So it seems like they underestimate more for females than males. I don't know why that would be. So let's have a look at these numbers then. Right, minus 7.1 for white Scottish. Let's look at the variation. Well, it increases for some racial groups and it decreases for others. And the differences are not huge. They're pretty closely grouped, I would say. So I would conclude from that data that you can't conclude anything at all. But that's not, of course, what the anti-racist educator website has to say. They try and analyze it with statements like this. The third group with a high level of underestimation is the Asian Indian group with 7.7%. I wonder how many teachers actually know whether their South Asian pupils are Indian, Pakistani, Bangladeshi, or Sri Lankan. They tend to be racialized in similar ways, so the impact of racial bias may equally be similar. In fact, if we add up those who are typically racialized as brown or South Asian, the numbers would be much higher, hinting at the important role of racial bias in teachers' estimation of grades. That's just total rubbish. What do you mean if you add up the results? You can't just add these together. Do you mean if you average them? If you average them, they would head towards the white Scottish figure. I mean, they're trying to make something out of nothing. And it also, I mean, their statistical analysis is just wrong. All right, let's carry on. The fourth group with noticeably higher levels of underestimation is African, Black, Caribbean, with 7.6%, followed by Asian, Chinese with 7.3%, white, non-Scottish with 7.2%, and white, Scottish with 7.1%. So these differences are minuscule, really. The prevalence of racial bias in teacher estimates from 2019 is clear, and the data that was not analysed in the SQA impact assessment would suggest that teachers tend to underestimate the ability of pupils of colour. Yes, the same as they underestimate the results of every pupil. So they're technically correct, but their implication is incorrect. Right, then refer to this. This is a comment from the SQA website with their equality assessment of the exam results. Right, race. Around 90% of candidate entries were either white, British, or white other, with the largest other ethnicity, Asian Pakistani, being 2.5%. Thus, each non-white ethnicity is a small data set. And small data sets are difficult to analyse and draw firm conclusions from, as the data tends to be variable, meaning it's often not possible to distinguish the natural variation found in small data sets from meaningful signals. Right, SQA. Absolutely correct. That is statistical common sense. So the number of pupils in the different race groups is so small, they're trying to analyse these minor differences and draw conclusions from them. You're basically just commenting on random noise. But let's see what the anti-racist educator writers say. Following critical race theory, such a statement, they're referring about this particular statement, is just a lazy cop-out that makes it easy to sweep racism under the carpet. Considering that we're looking at ethnic minority populations, it's pretty obvious that the percentages are going to be small. I mean, this is pitiful. Whoever wrote this should just be utterly embarrassed. Basically, they're displaying their ignorance, and they're displaying that they can't understand the common sense that SQA is speaking. So they're saying, well, of course the percentages are going to be small because they're minorities. Therefore, to say it's hard to detect statistical significance is racist. I mean, it's just, I don't know what word you use. It's just absolutely intellectually vacuous. In fact, having 10% of the general pupil population coming from non-white backgrounds is probably the highest rate we've ever had in Scotland. So what? How does that change the comment that SQA made? After the latest Scottish census data in 2011, ethnic minorities made up only 4% of the general population. Right, so this anti-racist educator website, it's written and edited, you assume, by people without the intellectual capacity to understand the issues that they're commenting on. But that doesn't stop it being quoted favourably on the GTCS website and being referenced as a resource for teachers in Scotland to refer to. So if there's injustice in the exam system, what are they going to want to do about it? Well, part of the process is already underway. Do away with exams, replace it with teacher assessment. That's the way of closing various attainment gaps. What else will they want? Will they want people of different races sitting different exam papers, have extra lessons available if you're of a certain race? Now, in my last video, I reported on people who are saying, basically, the exam system is just arbitrary. The people who succeed, it's just because the powerful people have decided that that's the sort of person they want to say is successful. So it's all just arbitrary. Everyone's really equal in ability, maybe just ability in different areas, and it just happens to be that the powerful people have decided they're just going to assess certain types of ability. I mean, that's completely untrue, but you can see where this is going to head. Because as soon as they start looking at these racial differences in exam performance and declare that their mission is to close them, that's the sort of steps they're going to have to look at taking. Right, the whole area of race and academic performance, I don't want to talk about it at all. For I've never talked about it publicly, and I would never talk about it again unless other people keep bringing it up and pushing it to the center and using it as a justification for various policies. Right, these are the reasons I don't want to talk about race and academic performance or exam results. First of all, it could suppress self-expectation within certain groups. So if people learn, though I'm in a group that on average in the past hasn't done as well as some other groups, that might lead people to think, oh, well, I probably won't do very well either. That's the last thing you want people thinking, isn't it? So don't talk about it. Right, number two, you'll find some nasty people who will use it to say, oh, you're such and such a race, so you must be a bit thick. So we don't want to give those people ammunition. Do you want to have this really spread around so everyone knows about these statistics every year? No. Right, the other problem is, number three, is people who are unintelligent actually believe that it indicates that they're cleverer than other people. So if people see, for example, that one race does better than another race, let's say, you know, the Indians do better than the Pakistanis overall, okay, a really unintelligent Indian person might believe that that implies that he is cleverer than Pakistani people. Okay, so let's just take this off the table completely. And problem number four is eventually you'll get to the stage, you'll start looking at the people who are coming out at the top, and if this is all about injustice and discrimination, then the suggestion will start to come out, right, what are they doing then? How are they cheating? How is the system rigged in the favor of Chinese people? What are they up to, really? And is it going to go down that road? I don't. So let's just leave the thing alone. So I wish we would all be left alone, but that's not going to happen because the equity mindset means you've got to keep digging, finding inequalities, highlighting them, and then rigging the system to deal with them. Now, with education and your career, a lot of it used to be to do with who you knew. Your family, you get a reference from a general or a bishop. Maybe it could be to do with your social class, your religion, even your race. That would determine what courses you could enter into, what jobs you could get. But we've pretty well done away with that. And instead, we've got a system of open exams. They're the same for everyone. Everyone's judged by the same standard. So in our society, there's not the need for prejudiced thinking. You don't need to think, oh, this is the sort of person who I think is probably going to be quite clever. Okay, if you think like that, you're going to make a lot of mistakes because we've now got a system of assessing people, and you can look at their exam results and other qualities and make an intelligent system. But the thing is with the equity mindset, it makes all politics easy. So when it comes to education, there's some pretty difficult questions like how do you improve the character of pupils? That's quite a tough question, isn't it? How do we gain academic excellence? How do we give them a broad base of knowledge? These are not easy things. But you can ignore all those, because if you're for the equity mindset, as are GTCS, Education Scotland, the SNP, the whole educational establishment, then no, you leave all those things. You focus on equity. You want equal outcomes between groups, and that's all that matters. And then along the way, teach the pupils to swallow the same ideology as well. Okay, carrying on the GTCS website, there's a video there of a teacher training lecturer from the University of West of Scotland, and here's a clip.
And I think when institutions start to use terms like diversity, are we in danger perhaps, I don't know, of losing the critical edge of issues around social justice and equality? So actually when I now deliver a lecture to the students in my institution, I will actually not actually talk about diversity. I'll say I'm going to talk to you about white privilege and whiteness theory.
So diversity is out of fashion. Now, no one saw the GTCS magazine that, because it's still riddled with it, absolutely. But they've always got to be keep moving on to something new. So the problem with diversity is, as though she's saying, it's a bit too neutral. It's a bit too much along the lines of, let's all live together in peace and harmony. But no, we don't want that anymore. We need to direct our attention at the problem. And the problem, of course, is whiteness. And they think that's the way that's going to produce a harmonious society. I don't think so.
And it's interesting because I attended a lecture by a Finnish scholar who said that, you know, I was wondering why Scotland called it curriculum for excellence and not curriculum for equity, because it's through equity that we achieve excellence. And that stayed with me. It was a really inspiring lecture.
Through equity, we achieve excellence. I mean, how does that make sense? I mean, they're virtually mutually exclusive. Equity, aiming for equality of outcome between groups. If you want excellence, you've got to pursue excellence, push every pupil to their full potential. Not be thinking, oh, well, we want to bring these up to these, we want these here. No, you just push everyone as far as they can go.
Because I always believe that you have BME teachers who come with, I always feel as if, added value. So, for example, many BME teachers will be able to relate to the young people, and the young people will say, actually, I can relate to such and such a teacher because they will understand.
So minority ethnic teachers basically are better in some way. So they should be favoured in recruitment and promotion, we assume, which is obviously unfair. It's going to lead to injustices to other people. But that's exactly what the Scottish Government commends. This is from the government website. This is talking about a survey of head teachers. Only 1.1% of white teachers indicated that ethnicity was a barrier. Yet the two quotes below from head teachers demonstrate a clear lack of awareness of the issues some black and minority ethnic staff face. So they're condemning these head teachers for making these comments. I have no reason to think that promotion is more difficult for teachers from a minority ethnic background. Well, head teacher, I hope that was anonymous, otherwise your career is over. Another one from a head teacher. I don't see that promotion is any more challenging for staff from minority ethnic backgrounds. There are fewer teachers from minority ethnic backgrounds. However, from my experience, I think they're proportionally represented at each level of the profession. Right, wrong, big red cross. The government said this teacher needs re-education. Because what they should be doing is putting this into practice. Such promotion panels should also be familiar with the possibilities of positive action measures as part of the Equality Act 2010. In other words, schools should be ready to employ positive discrimination, so all other things being equal, you give the job to the person on the basis of their ethnicity. So race determines who gets the job and who doesn't get the job. And this is apparently in the name of justice. So to conclude, GTCS, chronically politically biased, philosophically unbalanced, only shows an understanding of one perspective. It's worse than a waste of money. It subtracts from the effectiveness of Scottish education, as does Education Scotland, as does the whole education department. So it's part of a much wider problem, and the place it needs to be challenged is in the Scottish Parliament. So do share this video with teachers that you know, and do join the Scottish Family Party to support us in our fight against this problem. And there's a link below. Thanks for watching.